people. First, a couple of thanks that I have to acknowledge. Some people, my dear friends from the Hafter Cultural Center, Janine Rinaldi and Carol Mallison, who've done all of the technical work both this year and for the past 23 years. So please, a round of applause for the Hafter Cultural Center. Also, the friends from the Long Island chapter of the Italian American Studies Association who are here. I'd also like to thank Rita Monte from WHPC, Nassau Community College, and Giovanna Riema from the Radio Hofstra University for supporting us through the years. Who else? Oh, of course, the Association of Italian American Educators, who underwrite part of our lecture series, and Josephine Maeta here, who has been supporting us for many, many years, and all of you. So just a very brief note, next semester in the fall, I think we're going to do a film series. One of them is going to be a short independent film about war in Italy of an American soldier who's caught behind the lines. I think we're also going to try to invite Anton Evangelista, who has just done a documentary of Edward Jackson. Many of you know Edward Jackson from the Bronx, who oftentimes comes all the way to Hofstra for our lecture series. Unfortunately, he's not here tonight. But Anton has done a documentary about Edward Jackson titled Il Signor Jackson. We're going to try to screen that, and maybe one or two others as well. So let's begin, because we're a little late. And I want to just tell you our format is a little different this evening. I had originally scheduled this as a presentation of a book that we did after a conference here at Hofstra. Many of you attended that conference several years ago on Naples. But I'm going to give half of my time to a guest, a new friend from Naples, Massimiliano Verde, I'm going to introduce in a few moments. So just a brief history. Those of you who know Hofstra University, you know that my dear friend and colleague Pellegrino D'Acerno has a close tie with Naples. His father was from Naples, studied at the university there, and became a medical doctor, came to the United States in the 1920s, and delivered, by his count, an estimated 100,000 children at the hospital across the Hudson River in New Jersey, oftentimes being paid in kind by Italian immigrants with eggs or chickens or cheese or bottles of wine after their children were born. Just an interesting historical footnote: when Pellegrino D'Acerno's father proposed in the 1930s that Italian be taught at the Weehawken High School, the Ku Klux Klan burned a cross on their front lawn in the 1930s in New Jersey. Just something to remember. So a few years ago, we decided to do a conference dedicated to Naples, and the result is this book, which has just been published by Fordham University Press. This is the cover that they came up with. These were kinds of the covers that I had proposed, these images of fireworks in the Bay of Naples. But I'm happy to say that the photograph on the right, which was taken by a photographer from Naples, Gennaro Guarino from Posillipo, is actually on the front cover of on the back cover of the book. My interest in Naples derives from a course that I took here in 1984. In the fall of 1984, I took a course with the anthropologist Tom Belmonte. Tom became not only a dear friend, but a mentor and a colleague. In 1978, he spent a year in the slums of Naples near the port, describing the life of the underclass, the working poor of Naples. And the result of that year was a dissertation and his first book called The Broken Fountain. And Tom, along with Pellegrino D'Acerno, is responsible for my lifelong interest and love of Italy and Naples in particular. One of the people that was at the conference was the famous writer Eri De Luca, who is, by some accounts, Italy's most popular living author. And he came to the conference and gave a talk to the students on the 10th floor of the library here. Also at the conference was a very why does it not go to the next? I'm not sure, but Francesco Durante, a dear friend who happens to have the distinction of being the last person born on the island of Capri. After he was born, everybody on the island of Capri was delivered at the hospital in Naples. He is a journalist. He is a professor at the university, one of the universities there. He is the only professor of Italian-American literature. Here are some images by the writer William or Bill Papaleo, who has a studio on the Amalfi Coast. Bill Papaleo is the son of a professor who taught Italian-American literature at Sarah Lawrence College, now makes his life in Naples and the Amalfi Coast, and does these extraordinary paintings of contemporary recent immigrants to Naples, who come from obviously all over the world. Every time I go to Naples, I am simply astonished by how cosmopolitan a city it is. A city that sent millions of people around the world, not just to the United States, but all over the world, is now a mecca for migrants coming from North Africa, Sub-Saharan Africa, Southeast Asia, South Asia, and around the world. Oop. Why did we do that? Did I just hit something that... Some other images. We have an essay by Angelo Cannavacciuolo, who is a well-known Neapolitan writer. This is from his essay, Words in Journey. It's a photograph of a mosaic from Pompeii, from the House of the Faun, La Battaglia di Iso, by Mimmo Iodice, who's a famous Neapolitan photographer. We have an essay by Ilaria and Simone Marchese. Ilaria Marchese teaches here at Hofstra. Simone Marchese teaches at Princeton. And they wrote an essay about their experience of taking children to Pompeii and Herculaneum, and the richness of teaching ancient history to very, very young children and what that entails for us in the 21st century. We also have photographs of another famous, I'm not sure exactly why this is not working, but let's see, Neapolitan photographer by the name of Luca Di Martino. This is an image at the Bay of Naples. And the next one is an image of the Bay of Naples on a starry night. One of the essays in the book deals with the delirium of the Neapolitan Baroque. Those of you that have been to Naples, you know that Naples is a Baroque city par excellence, unlike, let's say, Florence, which prides itself on being a Renaissance city when it's really a medieval city. Naples is quite very much like Rome. It's really a Baroque city, but there's a very particular type of the Baroque, a kind of delirious Baroque. And this is an example of this, the famous Neapolitan architect Cosimo Fanzago from the Basilica of San Lorenzo Maggiore in the middle of the 17th century. There are other images here also. You may know this as the famous Certosa di San Martino on the Vomero, on the hill that overlooks Naples. And this extraordinary explosion of architecture, of art, of frescoes, and of paintings, oil paintings, including a famous painting by the Spanish artist Giuseppe de Ribera, who was active in Naples around the same time, maybe a little after, influenced by Caravaggio. And we will see an image of Caravaggio. This is an interior shot of the Cappella di San Severo, very famous jewel of art and architecture and erudite scholarship by a nobleman, a Neapolitan nobleman, who also engaged in some pretty strange medical experiments. Those of you that have been there, if you have descended to the lower part of the chapel, you will see these bodies that have been plasticized. The veins and the arteries have been injected with some kind of synthetic material, and it really looks like something from science fiction. I always have nightmares after I come out of that place. But I always have to go to the Cappella when I'm in Naples, because it is one of the most extraordinary places, not just in Naples, but in all of the world. This is a view of the vault, the glory of heaven, painted in the middle of the 18th century by Francesco Maria Russo. And this is one of the statues by Antonio Corradini. In this case, this is chastity, although I don't think too many of us have chaste thoughts when we see this woman, I have to say. Maybe that's a Freudian confession, I don't know. This is Francesco Querolo's Disillusion. Please note that fishing net is made out of a single piece of stone. It is absolutely extraordinary. The chapel is also famous for its labyrinthine floor. You see this quite often nowadays, but this was one of the first. I already got ahead of myself. The chapel is most famous for this incredible, absolutely stunning, extraordinary statue by Giuseppe San Martino of 1753, the famous Cristo Velato. The photograph does not do it justice, but we did get special permission from the superintendent of the chapel to reproduce these photographs in the book, which is not often given. The essay on the chapel is done by my dear friend Salvatore Napolitano, who not only has a PhD from the University of Naples, Federico II, but also from the Sorbonne, and is now in America, where he's expecting the birth of his first child. Salvatore Napolitano is a wonderful person. He was born in the city of Nola and is oftentimes my Virgil when I go to Naples. And he was the first person to take me to the Cappella many years ago. Here is another view of the Cristo Velato. I oftentimes say to people that I'm with or my students or in lectures that if the Cristo Velato had been in Florence, it would be just as famous as anything that Michelangelo had done. Unfortunately, these photographs don't do it justice. But the ability to render the face of the dead Christ under this veil, and not only the face, but the rest of the body as well, the whole body is under the veil, the head, the arms, the legs, and yet it is anatomically perfect, really an extraordinary work of art. And here is another image of the chapel that shows some of the works that you see there. Okay, and of course, you cannot go to Naples without a visit to the Church of Monte Pio di Misericordia. In the 16th century, a group of Neapolitan aristocratic families gathered together and decided to create a charitable organization, and the result was the Monte Pio di Misericordia, which is right on the Via Tribunale. And in the chapel there is the famous painting by Caravaggio, who spent a very critical period of his artistic career in Naples and was commissioned to paint a painting showing all the seven acts of mercy: feed the hungry, give water to the thirsty, visit the sick, visit the jailed, bury the dead. And I just want to point out to you not only the image of St. Martin cutting his cloak in half to give it to the naked beggar in the left foreground, but the image of, now I forget her name, the woman who goes to visit her father in prison, who is being starved, and gives him her own breast milk, thereby completing two of the acts of mercy in one act: visiting those in prison and feeding the hungry. Okay? And really an extraordinary, extraordinary work of art, one of the greatest works of art of the Baroque period. The last time I was there in Naples, last summer, I came across this painting, and in the Cappella, there was a Presepio. You know that Naples is famous for the Presepio, the art of the Presepio, right? In fact, one of my favorite writers, Luciano de Crescenzo, wrote a book. The title is Jesus Was Born in Naples, Gesù è nato a Napoli, meaning that because our concept of Jesus and Christmas was born on the Via San Gregorio degli Armeni, you know, the street where they make all of the Presepio figures, you know. And every time I go there, I marvel that, let's say, the one time I was there, the famous Italian actor Bud Spencer had died the day before. I don't know if you know him, but he was a famous Italian actor. And when I went to go visit one of the maestros who was working, he took me upstairs to the workshop where he had workers from all over the world, Morocco, Sudan, Indonesia. They were making these figures of the Presepio, and some of them were making figures of Bud Spencer. You know that you're famous when you have a figure for the presepio of yourself. You know, so they had people like Obama, you know, that you could put in your presepio. One of the fascinating things about the Neapolitan presepio is that it is a combination of tradition and the willingness to insert into a scene that is supposed to, let's say, 16th century Naples or the countryside outside of Naples, to insert, let's say, Maradona, you know, or in this case, Marek Hamsik, who just left for China. You know, contemporary figures in these presepio, they're really something extraordinary. I saw a presepio that was made of people from Caravaggio's paintings. It was absolutely extraordinary. And I mentioned that story to you because, for me, Naples is a city that, beyond all cities, is a city that is able to take its past, its present, and to imagine a future all at the same time. Naples, oftentimes, has been said to be a palimpsest. You know, in the Middle Ages, when manuscripts were so valuable, sometimes they were erased and used again, and sometimes scholars, like using ultraviolet rays or whatever, find out what was underneath, or a painting, what's underneath. Naples has layers and layers of history, you know, starting with the Greeks and then the Romans and the French, the Spanish, the Germans, the Americans, and everybody else. And it's this incredible amalgam of crossroads of civilizations. This is the interior of the San Carlo Opera House, which was completed in 1737. And I just want to recount to you this episode that I had several years ago. One of our guests here at the conference was Stefania Rinaldi. She is the direttrice of the Coro Bianco, the children's choir for the Opera House of San Carlo. She came to Hofstra and she spent 2 weeks every night training Hofstra vocal students to sing a concert of Neapolitan songs. So if you think that American students cannot sing O Solo Mio or O Soldato Innamorato, you're wrong, because in 2 weeks they were able to do it. It was an extraordinary experience. Then the following year, I went to Naples. She invited me to the San Carlo, and in the Giardino, the garden of the San Carlo Opera House, in an early summer evening as the sun was going down, she had a concert of the choral students. They were all like between 10 and 12 or 13, 14 years old, and they sang the most exquisite concert of music that I had ever heard in my life, including Stormy River, Moon River, and all of these like American gospel songs. And so the same way that American Hofstra students were singing Neapolitan songs here, Neapolitan and immigrant children in the Giardino de San Carlo were singing these famous American songs from the famous American songbook. It was really an extraordinary, extraordinary moment. I had said to you at the beginning, I'm going to conclude now and say, Tom Belmonte wrote that famous book in 1978 called The Broken Fountain. And several years ago, I went back to Naples as a kind of pilgrimage after Tom had died, and went to look for the Broken Fountain. I spoke to some of the people that he knew, and they told me where the fountain was. And this is what's left of the Broken Fountain. It's near the port. It's in the courtyard of a huge palazzo named after the Amendola family. And in the last pages of his book, which was written like in 1978, Tom had a reflection about why was it that this fountain came to be broken. The older people in the neighborhood and in the building and in the courtyard said to him, "Oh, Tom, you should have seen that fountain. It was beautiful. You know, it was from the 1700s, and children used to play there, and, you know, mothers used to wash the faces of their babies there." And Tom's whole book is a meditation of what poverty does to a great culture. Naples, you know, has, in my opinion, in some sense, almost never recovered from the Second World War and the American occupation. The Second World War had done tremendous material damage to the city of Naples, but the American occupation did a kind of moral damage to Naples. Not that it still suffers from that, but that is a key to understanding contemporary Naples. The ramifications and the repercussions of the Second World War are still being felt in Naples, I think. So that being said, that's my presentation. But what I'd like to do now is to introduce our special guest. Last year, I was fortunate to meet Massimiliano Verde, who has made it his life's mission to not rescue, because I don't think it needs rescuing, but to promote Neapolitan, not as a dialect. We've had this conversation before in the lecture series, that things like Venetian and Neapolitan and Sicilian are not dialects. They are languages in their own right. Some years ago, we had Gaetano Cipolla from St. John's here, who has made it his life mission to preserve Sicilian as a language, you know, going back to the 12th century. And Neapolitan lays claim to just as great a tradition as Sicilian or Dante's language. And so when the opportunity arose to bring Massimiliano here, I could not have not invited him. So please join me in welcoming Massimiliano Verde, the president of the Accademia Napoletana.
Thank you so much, Professor Pugliese. Thank you to, pardon for my English. I just speak Neapolitan or Napolitana and Italian, just a bit of English, but I try to speak in English. Well, of course, I have to thank. I'm a bit. It's a bit touching for me because for me it's touching this at this moment. So, thank you so much to everybody, Professor Pugliese, the entire University, Hofstra University, my friend, Dottoressa e Cavaliere Josephine Maietta, also I see also Signora Auriemma, Neapolitan like me. And well, I'm the president of Neapolitan Academy. It means an international organization to promote, to preserve, and to spread Neapolitan language and heritage all around the world. We cooperate with UNESCO because this language is a risk, like UNESCO said. So it means that our heritage, but also a great part of American Italo-American Italian-American heritage is at risk, because in this moment in Italy it's no possible to have a Neapolitan school to teach Neapolitan. So I began a work also with academician or all around the world, United States of course, but also with any Italian and any Southern Italian communities all around the world, such as of course here in the United States, but also in Brazil, in Europe, and we cooperate also with our friends of Magna Grecia, our friends of Greece, because Naples, Neapolis is a Greek city with a Greek heritage, but also this philosophy to life that is Neapolitan and also Magna Grecian soul. It's all. It's very very important. It's very very important because we say in Naples, for example, we have an Epicurean soul. It means, for example, the capacity to be able to love the quality of our life instead that the quantity of our life. That is an Epicuro soul we have in our culture. Or, for example, also that is common in the southern, mostly in the southern Italy, on South Italian heritage. Also, for example, to spread the conviali- the food. In Neapolitan, we say "a Romagna no rui, Magna no tre." It means that is also an Epicurean heritage from Magna Grecia. It means If we have the possibility, if we have a table and we there are two persons that are on the table to begin to eat, the door is open to other person. I mean the I don't know if it's correct to be hospitality. It's correct. Okay, so this hospitality is also a manuogression and a very, very important sense of life, also to live in the present, because the life is now and not in Neapolitan language that UNESCO say that it's a language, not a dialect. We don't have the future. We have the present, because we know that we have to enjoy the present. And as we enjoy the quality of life, the simple things of the life, more than quantity of that. So I started this international project with my friends all over the world. I have to also mention a colleague of me, Professor Miriam Iatako, that is a very important sociolinguistic professor, and we spread together a group of six thousand members, language right, derechos lingüístico en riesgo, es decir, oh, perdón, estaba por hablar en español. for any linguistical communities in risk, because unfortunately I have to say that to make a refrain. We have a problem in Italy, because I have to fight very much to introduce Neapolitan language in the scholar school. So our children in Naples are Neapolitan mother tongue. It means that our first language, like for example Sicilian, it's not Italian. But for example, is the Sicilian. I cooperate also with Dr. Genchi of the Accademia della Lingua Siciliana, and Academy of Sicilian Language. In our family, for example, my mother, when I was a child, they thought to me when I began to speak Neapolitan, parla bene. It means don't speak in Neapolitan. Well, this is a very problem, because to deny, to teach to our mothers, to teach to our children, do not speak our tongue, do not respect our heritage, unfortunately it's a great problem. It is also a violation of the chart of the rights of children that Italian states, for example, has signed. Because the article 29th of this chart said that any states that signed this chart, including of course Italian states, that defend of course Venetian or Sardo or other language, but any states that have signed this chart has to teach to the children the respect and the value of their mother tongue and their heritage. Well, not very often this happen in Italy, and this is a great problem, because if we lose our Neapolitan language, we and also heritage, we lose also a part of Italian American heritage. We can think for example to the Neapolitan song or Neapolitan poetry or Neapolitan food, the wine, Mediterranean diet, famous in all over the world. Includes we lose, for example, someone that it's very common in New York, for example, the fast food or the street food, because. For example, in Naples we have a secular tradition of the street food, and maybe Neapolitan, Southern Italian carried on in the United States this tradition come posso dire, mi puoi dare una mano, cucinare tu. To cook, okay, ce l'avevo qua, Nagab. To cook on the street, for example, to cook pizza or for example, macaroni. Macaroni, for example, or pizza are Neapolitan words, yes, of course, that are inserted in Italian vocabulary, like apocondria di Pino Daniele. But we have a problem because as I said, it's not so easy to have respect for our language. Unfortunately, also because our language, Neapolitan, very often is treated like something of bad, something that is for somebody of the criminality or bad or social degradation, and it is not good. It's not good to teach to our children. To teach Neapolitan this way, so I make a pedagogical work just to teach to our children to have respect for our language, to have respect for our heritage, because our language Neapolitan. But the Neapolitan culture merit respect because it's the language of Caruso, it's the language of Antonio De Curtis Totò, it's the language of the mask of Pulcinella, it's the language of the soul, the love. And also Neapolitan is the language of resistance. Professor Pugliese spoke before about the American occupation. Well, we can say that Neapolitan is also the language of resistance to the fascism, because we in Naples before the liberation of Milan, the people of Naples fight and destroyed the Nazi army just with our hands, but how? With our language. We reconstituted ourselves into an anti-fascism people with our language, because the women of our people in Naples, the children, Gennaro Capuzzo, for example, the Naples is the golden medal for the resistance. Well, all that called themselves. Help and make this resistance to the Nazi army with our language. Cacciamo sti infamuna, cacciamo sti criminale, ramma ce la fa. This is our language. This is our language, anti-fascist, a language of peace, of love, of song, poetry. It is not a language of social degradation. It's not the language of the criminality. So, but it's a language that everybody song in the world, from O Sole Mio, O Esce Sole, O Torna Surriente, or like this. It's the language of Teatro San Carlo. It's the language of the opera, because opera born in Naples, not in Florence or Venice. I have all my respect for Venice, Florence, Milan, all my respect. But I pretend respect for my roots, for my heritage, for my language, that because this heritage, this language, make proud Italy, make proud Italy all around the world. Italy is known, thank you, the Neapolitan song, thank you, Neapolitan food, thank you, Neapolitan theater. Thank you to the Neapolitan music. So I'm very passionate in this work that is a full democratic world, because I make culture, for example, in the, when I come back to Naples, I will begin a project with a Neapolitan school. Well, this school is in a place with social problems, but Neapolitan can be also a way to help these children so they can understand the importance of their language, to not consider the degradation of this language. Because this language is not a myth of the criminality, of the social degradation. So I will start with a Neapolitan school, a project, and I will inform also the UNESCO of this project. Also, I want to say many things. Also, for example, our heritage is famous all around the world, and for example, also in the United States. If we can think about Caruso or Gilda Mignonette, for example. Well, Gilda Mignonette died before to see Naples, some miles before to see, and she like Caruso or many many authors, many singers. She took our heritage, the beauty of our heritage, all around the world. So please, if you desire, if you wish to have more information, you can contact me. If you like the idea, Accademia Napoletana on Facebook. I have also a personal profile into the UNESCO for the International Year of Indigenous Languages. Because Neapolitan is a language of the cultural community of Naples. And this is, like UNESCO say, the Southern Italian heritage. Without considering the noble Sicilian language, because one other thing, if it's correct that the first document in Italian, it's not from Dante Alighieri, but it's the Placido Capuano of 1960. Sono emozionato, ci pazienza. Okay, before Dante Alighieri, Placido Capuano is the first representation, an official document in which we have the separation from the Vulgar Latin from Classical Latin, and it is in Volgare Pugliese, 960 dopo Cristo. It's in Neapolitan, okay, but the much more. For example, when we know that Italian is from Florence, okay, my great respect for Florence, my great respect for Dante, my great respect for Dante Alighieri, for the Divina Commedia. But we and the Sicilian, who knows that Sicilian is the first Italian? Who knows? Thanks to Josephine Maietta. But the majority, no. In Italy is the school, in no one school teach that the first document in Volgare Latin popular on the first Italian is Placido Capuano, that is in Neapolitan language, and no one schools teach that Sicilian is the first Italian, il Volgare più perfetto, the most perfect late in volgare, non so come si dica in from said Dante Alighieri. So I have to finish, I desire to invite you to follow us. That is a very pedagogical project, a very pedagogical work that is very important also for the United States. And I want to also to remember that the right to do happiness, it's a Neapolitan right, because Benjamin Franklin studied from Gaetano Filangieri, La scienza della legislazione, and because he stayed in contact with Gaetano Filangieri from Naples, from Vico Equense, Neapolitan, and he inserted this right in the American Constitution Convention. But the first representation in the world of this right of happiness, il diritto alla felicità, di Gaetano Filangieri from Naples, he stayed in contact with Benjamin Franklin. Benjamin Franklin studied from Gaetano Filangieri, and not on the contrary. This is history. We have the professor Pugliese. He can say if I joke or I say something of crazy. And the first representation of this right of happiness, il diritto alla felicità, is San Leucio. San Leucio is a complex, a community in the near Naples, San Leucio Caserta, in which Ferdinand IV of Bourbon of Naples created a community in which there was not a difference from woman and man. It means the first right to the equal right, the first representation, also the equal right, is in Naples, in the Statuto di San Leucio. But in the Italian school, I suppose also in the American school, but it's my idea, it's my hypothesis, nobody teach that. Why? Please ask to yourself, why? This is a great problem, because without the truth of history, we don't have democracy, we don't have future, not for one, not for our children. And this is a great problem. So the culture, the study of the real history also of Italy, can be help us to understand that happened in Italy, but also all that happened in New York, in the United States, because the mark of Neapolitan heritage is very strong, and Southern Italian heritage is very strong in the United States. And this is in our soul, in our way of life. And it means also a Magno Grecian heritage, because everything is born in Greece. The real democracy is born in Greece. And in Naples we have also the first representation of democracy, like Statuto di San Leucio, but also thanks to our father, the Greeks, with Le Fratrie, because Naples is the social organization of Naples, Neapolis, that was born before Rome, is an organization in Fratrie, in Neapolitan language we use also today fratma or fratata. Fratma, it means my brother. Well, it represents also now this millennial culture of Naples, that is also and more a Magno Grecian culture. I'm working also with the University of Athens in this project, and I realized with the University of Athens a video that I wish to show you. It's a representation of Neapolis and Hellenic Campania to show our heritage in common with Greece, and it is in Neapolitan. It's a prayer to Zeus. It's in Neapolitan. You can hear my voice in a while, and also in a classical Greek that I realized with Dr. Bekakos of the University of Athens. After video, I wish to spend just one other word to finish. It's possible. Thank you. Mary, mi puoi aiutare un attimo per piacere? Ah, thank you so much. Grazie. As my English, speaking English, also this text is not a perfect English. See, if you, pardon, if you can, for the video, if you can, okay, yes, okay. Voice is perfect?
Yeah, all the audio.
Just a moment. Of course, I have always to thanks my professor Caloiandolo, Raffaele Bracale e dottor Renato De Falco.
Zeus maguada, pa liberazione nostra testa regava. Oire, la capa curnata tua, tutte sti cose mie nascettero fuori. A terra mamma dea, i cimi scargo per in montagna. Umara è tutta quella canzone sta. Zeus figlia grossa, tu con cora raggiata, sciattruca come la capa. E tutto principio. I tutta fila, tu caterzo scuturia, caprena niente, tu ca tutta fila, bomba le frugola, per terzè, tu ca con me lo rigi ogni formigliente, stamma a sentire, faccia la buona salute, e così ne c'è la pace, abbondanza senza peccato. Thank you.
Thank you and pardon for the not correct English text, I think. I want to finish this this conversation, and pardon, but I'm very emotional. So my personality is very strong, very Neapolitan. Perciò faccio pochi burdel. But it's my blood, it's my heritage, it's my roots. So something to that I have to remember. Well, uniqueness is a quality that is hard to define, but Naples seems to come very close to having it, however defined. ICOMOS, UNESCO, September 1995. So I want to say, also UNESCO recognize our unicity and the possibility that we have in our heritage, in our language. We have to work for us, for respect over our heritage and our language. But we can work together for our for the democracy, for the real philosophy to saper campa, to join in our lives, because today we live in a sort of homologation. This homologation destroyed our identity, our diversities, and all that diversity merit respect. So in Neapolitan language we have millennial, a coexistence of millennial and cultural diversities, that they live in our language, in our melody, in our music, peacefully, in full harmony. So we can be also an example for ourselves, but also for the entire world, for a better world, I think. An example, something that in Italian school it's not studied. Giambattista Basile, Locunto degli Cunti, O Pentamerone, a great work of fair tale that anticipated Cinderella or Gatto con gli Stivali, or it's a masterpiece of the entire literature that is in Neapolitan language. And this Giambattista Basile, Locunto degli Cunti, live this harmony of millennial diversity and cultural expression, from Oscan to Greek, to French, to Spanish, to English, that is to Arab, to Persian, that is Neapolitan language and heritage. But in Italian school, no school teach that. No school talk about that masterpiece that Benedetto Croce said that was a very masterpiece, an historical masterpiece. Why? I have a reply, but it's a personal reply. But it's a problem, because without safe Neapolitan language, Neapolitan music, Neapolitan literature, we are poor. Siamo più poveri, siamo più poveri. And I want to finish with this word of Raffaele Viviani. I think that I don't know if I have the time. Well, no problem. Well, Raffaele Viviani. Who knows Raffaele Viviani? No one. Raffaele Viviani is a playwright, Neapolitan playwright. His work is before Vittorio De Sica. He's one of the fathers of the neorealism, but no one knows that. Raffaele Viviani, if I can, but I don't. Well, Raffaele Viviani from Naples, It's not known why. Maybe he was born in Castellammare di Stabia, Napoli. I don't know. But the lost thing. Well, Raffaele Viviani says that. I will try to translate in English. I'll try. Volete essere sempre zingara voi? Siete uomini voi? No. Fino a quando non sarete liberati dalla schiavitù, voi siete solo pecora. That means. Io chiedo l'aiuto di Stan in questo. Per favore, me lo devi tradurre bene questo. Grazie. Allora, grazie a sé a tutto quanto, vuol dire napolitanamente. Thank you so much to everybody. Pardon for my bad English. And pardon for my emotion, but it's a very important, and I want to thank you to everybody, Professor Pugliese at the entire university, Josephine Maietta, my darling friends. Se mi puoi tradurre questo, che è importante.
We will translate that, but I just want to ask any questions, comments from. I see many of you nodding because you understood this, but you want to be.
Però glielo devi spiegare bene che significa.
Zingara.
Ma non è un'accezione negativa.
No. Do you want to be? I don't want to use the negative word of gypsies, but do you want to be worthless people? You. Are you really, truly men? No. Fino a quando non sarete, until you are actually free from slavery, you are simply sheep.
This is Raffaele Viviani. Grazie,
Stefano. Just to put this in context, kind of global context, philologists and linguists tell us that every year the world loses more than 12 indigenous languages. Usually in places like Africa and Asia, Latin America, the rainforests of, you know, Brazil. So it is not, it is a global problem, okay? And Massimiliano made a reference, I don't know if you caught it, but it is against the United Nations Charter for any government to prevent the speaking, the writing, and the reading of an indigenous language. In Italy, you know this story, that when Italy was created in the middle of the 19th century, the apocryphal story is that, who was it? One of the parliamentarians said, you know, they gather in Torino, which was the first capital of Italy, and one turns to the other and said, okay, abbiamo fatto l'Italia, ora dobbiamo fare gli italiani. You know, we've made Italy, now we have to make Italians. And one way to make Italians was to impose a single language at the expense of every other language. And so, you know, this was resisted for decades until there was, you know, mass compulsory education, and probably even more so after the Second World War with the development of television in Italy, where then you finally have, let's say, all Italians speaking a language. But you know that a generation ago there was the fear among cultural anthropologists, and you know Tom Belmonte taught this to me, that the various languages or quote-unquote dialects of Italy would eventually disappear. I'm happy to say that, as many of you know, you can now go to Italy and you have publishing houses that publish in Neapolitan. You have publishing houses that publish in Sicilian. So, but it's a constant battle against this kind of globalization and homologization of global culture, that we all have to look the same, that we all have to speak the same, that we all have to dress the same, and it's to me as an individual and even as a scholar, it's a terrible loss of culture. You know. Okay. So, questions.
No, non tanto una domanda quanto un commentario. Io sono nata a Monteleone di Puglia. E facevamo parte della Campania prima, quindi certo. Il nostro dialetto è quello napoletano.
Brava.
2 anni fa sono andata al mio paese, piccolissimo, ci saranno 800 abitanti, e una delle mie amiche mi ha fatto una domanda in dialetto e io ho fatto un ragionamento in dialetto, perché manco dal paese da 51 anni, quindi ho il dialetto di 51 anni fa. E lei mi dice: ma tu lo parli sto dialetto? Ed ero l'unica americana adesso che parlava il dialetto in frasi complete.
Perché lei se lo fa questo? Perché secondo lei?
E penso perché l'influenza della radio, della televisione e forse le forze culturali di non dover rimanere con il dialetto perché è arretrato, perché è quello dei poveri, perché invece a me piace parlare il dialetto. Era come tornare alle mie origini, ma non è accettabile.
Non è accettabile forse che uno Stato che si definisca veramente autenticamente democratico ripudi o diciamo faccia questo ostracismo verso le lingue locali? Perché voglio dire anche una cosa, mi sia permesso, l'articolo 6, ci sono tantissimi articoli, noi abbiamo, allora mi dispiace per voi, ma abbiamo la Costituzione italiana la più bella del mondo, mi dispiace dirlo qua negli Stati Uniti. In realtà molto, molto di napoletano, come dicevo, c'è anche nella Costituzione americana, ma anche in quella italiana. In realtà la Repubblica italiana, all'articolo 3, dice che tutti i cittadini sono uguali davanti alla legge, bla 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 bla, anche senza distinzione di lingua, uno. L'articolo 6 della Costituzione italiana dice che tutti i cittadini, che la Repubblica promuove e difende le lingue minoritarie. Napoletano non è considerato né minoritario né maggioritario, né esiste proprio, quindi nemmeno il suo, quello che lei chiama dialetto. Quindi lei è stata cancellata, lei è stata abolita.
Sì,
questa
sì.
Lo capisce, vero, quello che sto dicendo?
Sì, sì.
La gravità di quello che io dico.
Ma mi sono sentita esattamente così,
esattamente.
Perché era come voler chiudere una porta, dire se tu sa- e io so parlare in italiano,
certo,
anche.
Anch'io credo che anch'io mi sappia esprimere abbastanza bene italiano.
E infatti io quando sono cresciuta parlando il dialetto. Quando ho incominciato le scuole ho imparato l'italiano, e quindi è come essere bilingue, perché ci sono regole precise per il dialetto che io mi ricordo.
Certo, certo.
E invece no, non vogliono, non lo so, che non vogliono essere ricordati del passato, non lo so.
No, c'è un problema. Allora glielo dico io in due paroline, secondo me, questa è la mia opinione. Innanzitutto, se lei vuole ci dia una mano, noi saremo molto felici e fieri come Accademia Napoletana di dare una mano a lei, voce a lei, in primis. Quindi su Facebook io lascio anche i miei contatti senza problemi. C'è un grosso problema. L'UNESCO, quando dichiara praticamente che la napoletana è una lingua, non a caso, come anche il siciliano lo è, non a caso, ma disegna per i parlanti napoletani, quindi anche la Puglia, disegna i contorni politici più o meno di quelli che furono i limiti geografici del Kingdom of the Naples, quindi il regno delle due Sicilie. E questo dà molto fastidio. Questo però significa che uno Stato che non è forte non è realmente democratico. Voi negli Stati Uniti avete preso coscienza della guerra tra Nord e Sud. Voi avete preso coscienza dei disastri che anche qui sono accaduti con i nativi americani. Credo che questo, e io vi faccio io un applauso per questo, ma in Italia questo sulle nostre lingue minoritarie non è accaduto, non accade. Quindi io, sempre in una forma molto democratica, molto rispettosa di tutti e di tutti, io invito a seguirci, a seguire questo lavoro pedagogico per i bambini, perché ho un bambino, quando ci leva la lingua, uaglione è finito.
So just very briefly, I don't know if you could follow that discussion, you know, it was a question of, let's say, the suppression of dialect, and Massimiliano was saying that a country, a nation that is truly democratic cannot or would not suppress an indigenous language, because what happens is that the person and that entire culture and that history is simply canceled from the pages of history. And we cannot permit that to happen. Why not? Why not? I mean, it's very difficult for me to get American students to understand that for most Italians, the original, let's call it dialect or language, you know, is their first language. It's their first language. They learn Italian in school. I had this experience myself, you know, growing up in a family where my mother was from Calabria, my father was from Yeah, Avellino. And, you know, so I go to school thinking I speak Italian, only to be told on the first day of school that you're not speaking Italian, you know. And in a way, it was sort of like dismissing my entire two families, two cultures, you know. And it was only much later that, and I would go to Italy, and, you know, a dialect word would come out, and people would make fun of me, and I was embarrassed, and it took like a whole lifetime to get over that. You know, that's not an unusual thing. Because, you know, Italy was so a nation state created in such a way that had like an inferiority complex. You know that I told this to my students the other day in class. In France, the dictionary is published by the government. You know, you can never imagine something like that in Italy. They're much more anarchists at heart, and thank God for that. Another question, comment? Yes.
Just one observation, which ties right into the Neapolitan language, is that many scholars go to, as many of you know, but many scholars go to where Italians emigrated to in order to study the preserved... the preserved dialect, like yourself, ma'am, outside of Italy, where it hasn't been influenced by media of other languages, other cultures. And if I may add one comment, my mother here and I, we took her father, my Italy, at 92 years old, and we brought him to the small town Formia, many of you probably know, Formia Gaeta, Maranola, and we plopped him down in the piazza, and he just started chatting away, but he was speaking the perfect dialect of Formia, which was Napoletano, of 100 years ago, which is the one that he spoke in home, at the home in here, you know, so... la stupiti, yeah, I don't know how to say it. People were just blown away that there was this 92-year-old guy that came from New York and he spoke the perfectly preserved dialect that they didn't even know. It was just, it was amazing. It was amazing.
The dialect exchange. We had the same experience. 2007, we went back to Calabria, my wife's town, for the first time in a generation. And, you know, my wife is speaking dialect with her relatives, and the older relatives, the younger relatives would say, what's that word? We never heard it. And the older relatives would say, well, we haven't heard that word since, like, the time of, like, guerra or whatever, you know? Because what happens is the dialect in America is frozen in the year that you came here. Whereas the dialect, the language in the town actually evolved because people are watching television, they go to school, something happens, there's new technology, there's a word for computer, which is computer, you know. By the way, you know there is no word for privacy in Italian? There is no word for privacy in Italian. I tell this to my students. That tells you something about the culture, no? Another comment, question? I have to tell you this. Oh, Angelo.
You say that the dialects remain frozen. However, the dialects also absorb Americanisms, which come out, you know, thinking they think they sound Italian, but they're really Americanisms. We all know what they are. Bascianiente. There's no such word in Italian. What's the other ones? Baccaus. Baccaus is a famous one.
Maybe you can say something about your work other places. Like Massimiliano is concerned not only with the preservation of Neapolitan, but other indigenous languages too. So he's gone to Greece, he works in Spain, he's gone to other places.
Yes.
He works for the preservation of other indigenous languages as well, not just Neapolitan.
Yes, because it's a work for human rights, to defend the language of our community, of our people. It's defending human rights. So for that I preserve my language, of course. I try to defend and promote the Neapolitan heritage in Italy, all around the world, also in the United States, of course. But like I said, I cooperate with this, for example, Real Academia de Cultura Valenciana for the Valencian language. They have many problems with Catalan. I saw I saw a bad social cultural situation in Valencia because they are under pressure of the Catalanista cultura. That it's no good. So another example, for example, I cooperate with Accademia della Lingua Siciliana, Dottor Fonso Genchi, che voglio ricordare qua. I work also with the Professor Miriam Iataco from the Language Rights Derechos Linguistico Riesgo. My work was introduced by Professor Sociolinguistic Miriam Iataco. She is from Peru. She fight for the to defend Aymara and Quechua. My work was introduced at the Columbia University for a symposium last April in the preparation of the International Year of Indigenous Languages. As I said, I have a profile there in this page, and I put my documentary, video documentary, and so on. So also, for example, I have contact with a professor in Brazil, with my friend, my special friend, Neapolitan of Neapolitan origin, Professor Piero Nardella Dellova, lawyer of human rights, or Professor Ivan de Oliveira Duraes in São Paulo. So it's for the local, for example, with the University of Urca. Of regional Universidade Regional do Cariri de Brazil, to protect to defend the local Native American or South, I don't know. So it's an international work in which Neapolitan is not superior, but not neither inferior to any others. It's just a request to defend, to preserve this language and this heritage as the human rights of Neapolitan people. This is my work, in cooperation with others.
Yes. So, unless there are any other comments or criticisms, by the way, I could give you many, many historical examples of this. For example, you know, when Francisco Franco was the dictator of Spain, it was illegal to speak Catalan in Barcelona. The only place you could speak Catalan was in the soccer stadium. Or I'll give you another example. Those of you that have been to, let's say, the northeast of Italy, like the Dolomiti, Bolzano, whatever, where the culture is Germanic, you know, the fascist regime insisted that you change your name from Johann to Giovanni. They even went so far as to go into the cemeteries and erase the names from the tombstones and cross out Johann and put Giovanni on the tombstones. So that they could say, this area has always been Italian. It's never been German. It sounds very much like 1984, no? And in Naples itself, you know the Via Toledo, right? The Via Toledo that goes down to the Piazza del Plebiscito from the museum up there to all the way down to the
Largo di Palazzo.
Mussolini insisted, because Via Toledo was named after a Spanish viceroy, that Via Toledo be changed to Via Roma.
Yeah. Bravo, bravo, Stan.
You know,
bravo,
this is
bravo,
a little
Stan,
bit of history.
Bravo.
Or like all of the hotels, the grand hotels in Italy had to be changed to alberghi, albergo. They didn't want the English word. Or they didn't want like the name of a street in Italy to be named after a Spanish figure, you know, so it became Via Roma. Si. These examples of the government intervening in our language are like almost infinite. Almost. Yes.
Grazie. Thank you so much. In this case, we have another two people. The first neorealist, come si dice, regista.
Director.
Elvira Notari, from Naples, and other way. Again, Raffaele Viviani. Raffaele Viviani denounced the real fascism. The real fascism before Pierpaolo Pasolini in the negli anni 30,
in the 30s, yeah.
He denounced this Mussolinian political to destroy the Neapolitan language, and so the social degradation of Neapolitan language begin under the fascism. So I don't want to say that my actual state or my actual political state is like this of Benito Mussolini. I cannot say this. But the conditions are the same. The situation of my language are the same. The representation of my people, if this is a very important example. If I speak in my mater tongue, I mean Neapolitan, in Italian television, I have two possibilities. I cannot speak in this way in Italy. I cannot speak in this way in Italian public television, neither private. Peggio. Because I can just consider, they just consider myself or in a degradation. For example, you are a Pulcinella, you are a clown, okay? When Pulcinella is a mask of 3,000 years, okay? Okay. Or like a mafioso. So my language is represented in Italy like a language of the clown or a language of the ignorant, ridiculous, simpatic, funny, ignorant or criminal. I ask to you, is it possible in a democratic state this situation? And this is the same situation from the Sicilian in Italy.
That's
okay, but yes, it's better. Okay. La cosa, la giornata è sole, l'aria serena, roppa la tempesta, caccaria fresca, ma pare già una festa. Che bella cosa è la giornata è sole. Manato sole, più bello ne, oh sole mia, sta in fronte a te, oh sole mia, sta in fronte a te, sta in fronte a te.
Bravo!
Caruso, pardon me. Caruso, Giglia Mignonet, pardon me, please.
Folks, Hofstra University Program in Italian Studies, with thanks and appreciation to Dr. Massimiliano Verde, President of the Accademia Napolitana, for preserving and promoting Neapolitan language, history, and culture. Thank you very much. Have a good summer. We'll see you in the fall.